So, good afternoon, friends. Sorry for the delay because of some technical problem with the audio from computer, and that's why I'm again joining you on the my mobile with mobile apparatus. Today we don't have or we don't require a PowerPoint, and that's why I'm going to discuss with the mobile again. So time lag is there, but we'll fulfill that difficulty. Now I think everyone is getting my voice. Okay, are you getting my voice? Sure. Yes. So thank you for overwhelming response from all of you. Everyone was not getting my voice, and there are a number of calls to my clinic, to my mobile, were there, and that itself suggests that number of practitioners, number of students are watching my Facebook live sessions, and it's a very good thing that you are getting potentiated towards the homeopathy with the help of those lectures. So thank you again, and we'll start with today's session. It's a session for question and answers. And what happened that I got the questions at the last moment, just 5 minutes to 2:30, I got number of questions. Actually, I suggest that all of you must go through the questions or whatever may be the queries and ask me before a day, so that I can think over them. I can answer your queries in a proper manner. So generally, if you will do this, that will be better for all of you. Okay. So there was one question asked by Dr. Anita that, sir, we reach to the exact similimum generally. We get the results. But number of times it happens that even after getting good similimum, we cannot choose a right potency or sometimes the repetition. So please guide us regarding those. My suggestion towards Dr. Anita is that she should watch the videos, YouTube videos, and I have taken three lectures or two lectures regarding the potency dilemma, and they are already explained over there in detail. So if still you cannot get the answer, I will definitely help you in future lectures. I will ask all of you that you must you go through those lectures of potency dilemma, and if you are not getting satisfied, I will definitely work out for you, and I will mention that in future lectures. So today it is not topic of a potency dilemma. That's why I will suggest to go for that. We are discussing regarding the biocombinations and biochemics and queries regarding it. But there was one more question, sir, whether we can use two or more dynamic potentized homeopathic medicines at a time. If we give two medicines at a time, whether it will going to form a new medicine or whether it will act separately. So this was the question. Basically, my suggestion is that when you are giving two medicines, you are not making a one medicine out of it. You are not putting two medicines in one bottle and you are giving to it. If you are giving two different medicines at a time, at a different times, then it is a different issue. Sometimes it happens that a patient comes to you with a acute phase. He is already in a chronic state. For example, he is taking your treatment for rheumatism. He is having chronic rheumatism, and he comes to you with acute phase. At that time, the chronic state you have to tackle with the constitutional remedy, antimiasmatic remedy, whatever it may be. Along with, you have to deal with his acutes, because unless you deal with the acutes, patient will not going to come to you again. You have to handle that case at that time. Patient should settle at that time, and for that purpose, an acute remedy required. It is not that you are mixing chronic with acute. Here you have to give a chronic as a constitutional generally I used to give chronic remedy as a constitutional 3 doses and then followed by an acute remedy. Mixing two together causes a problem. If you are not mixing two together, you are giving it a different time, it is not, nothing happens. Because if your concept of dynamics is very clear, then you will understand it very clearly. We'll take simple example. We'll take an example of a calcarea agave, and its complementary is rustox. Calcarea pace is very, very, very slow pace is there. Rustox, in comparison to the calcarea, it goes up fast, very, very, very high pace. What happens? The two pace are completely different. Patient comes to you in a chronic state. A chronic patient of a rheumatism comes to you in an acute phase, and he requires that pace to be matched at that time specifically. So even though you have given him a calcarea at that before that, calcarea will not going to cure this acute phase immediately. You have to match that pace. So by giving rustox as a complementary remedy along with that, never produces any problem. And in fact, you will see that patient will be happy after getting a result with rustox. And then he will remain to you with you. Thereafter, he might require a rustox or he might not require a rustox. It depends. But to tackle that acute phase, acute remedy is always required. And if you use that specifically, then patient will settle very early. There are number of examples. Number of practitioners used to ask me, sir, I'm taking homeopathic treatment since long time and my pain is not getting settled, and how to go ahead, because I have already taken 6 months homeopathic treatment. Then I suggest that instead, can you give me a chance that I will treat you? And I took their case. I considered the chronic remedy, whatever it may be, along with acute remedy, along with biochemics or biocombination depending upon the situation, and I prescribe remedy, and within first 15 days or 1 month, patient has settled completely. Patient replies, yes, my 80% problem is settled now. This is the rapid pace. Unless and until you match, it is not possible to get the very early results in your practice. One important thing I again and again tells you, that everyone is not practicing in an area where the patients who understand the chronic disease, acute disease, ideal cure, palliation, you are practicing at a village level where patient only knows that they should feel better. And in these cases, if you want to hasten the result or process of recovery, then these acute remedies are required, as well as biochemics and biocombinations are required, and they are very, very helpful at that time. So this is the answer, that don't mix them together in one bottle. You give them separately, they act separately, because in dynamics, if you are giving two different stimulus at two different times, never gets mixed, because human is that much confident, dynamic, that he can react to n number of dynamic stimulus separately. You are there along with your parents, along with your friends, along with your wife or husband, along with your brothers and sisters. And what happens? You react separately to each of them. Your reactions are different. It doesn't happen that someone, your wife have told something to you and you are reacted as if she is your sister. It never happens. You react in a separate manner. In dynamics, with a complex human being, even though very complex materially and physically, materially, physically and dynamically, he reacts in a proper manner, because brain is very strong over there. The mind is very strong over there, and which reacts separately to different dynamic stimulus. Similarly, when you give homeopathic remedy, at that time also, if you give two different stimulus, it doesn't get mixed together. If you put them in a bottle and mix it together and give it to the patient, then it is a different thing. This is not advised by anyone. And that's why The law of simplex is very important to understand. Giving a single simple remedy to a patient at a time, we miss this at a time. At a time is called as a law of simplex. So if you are giving, for example, the 2 days you have given Belladonna, the patient comes to you in the evening, the state has changed and patient might require Rustox, you can give the Rustox. It doesn't mean that you have mixed Belladonna with Rustox. For Belladonna, patient has reacted in a different manner. Now you are giving Rustox and patient is again reacting in a different manner. So it never causes any trouble to the patient. So this is most important thing you must understand what I want to say. One more question was there. How much is the duration of action of a biochemic medicine? You cannot define it separately. Or you cannot say that this much is specific action. It varies from individual to individual. It depends on the situation. So, for example, a patient comes to you with a chronic muscular rheumatic element, and you have started with calcarea phos or calcarea fluor along with that, and you are giving it for a month, and patient again returns back, and you observe that there is a lot of change, but still he requires because the degenerative process is marked, osteophytes are marked. So you can give it for a longer duration. It doesn't create any trouble because whatever you are giving, it is not totally material. It is in a very molecular level. So it will not cause any trouble to the patient even though you repeat it for a longer time of duration. So basically, you cannot find it out or label specifically as this much is the specific action of that remedy. It varies from case to case. It depends upon the situation, whether it is acute or whether it is chronic, and accordingly you have to use your inorganic salts. So that is most important thing one must know. Then what is the role of biochemic medicines in antenatal care? That was the question. Yes, definitely biochemics and biocombinations plays a very vital role in antenatal care. Only thing is that how do you handle them right from the start? If you are doing homeopathic gynec practice or gynec obstetric practice, I will suggest that you start it right from the first month. You find it out what is required. If it has been required, give it. If it doesn't require, don't give it. It depends upon the situation. Generally, it has been advocated that please give the iron and calcium to the patient for each and every patient for the during antenatal care. My suggestion is that if you are giving it in a proper quantity in the food, if it is given through the natural sources and patient is consuming it in the natural circumstances or natural elements in the food, there is no need to supply it again. If there is a need, if you find it out, yes, there is a need, the patient is developing iron deficiency anemia, or patient is not having a proper food. It happens with the village females. They are not getting a nutritious food in their diet. They never get the green vegetables every time. At that time, you can give medicine. And you can add those medicines which are required depending upon the situations. If you are giving the biochemic remedies, you can give biocombination number 1 if needed. You can give biocombination number 26 at the end, the third trimester, or generally 7, 8, 9 months. In the last month of also you can give 26 number. But along with that, for developing a proper iron quantity or iron as well as a calcium, you can give biochemic remedies depending upon situation and depending upon need. Whether to stop the iron or stop the calcium from the patient, it depends. It varies again. You have to find it out. You have to watch it from the patient, that from which socio-economic state patient comes, whether he is getting proper diet, whether he is having everything in his food. You have to understand them and accordingly you have to think. If it has been needed, you provide it in material quantity also if it has been needed. Physiological doses sometimes require. If there is absolutely marked anemia, a patient is having the 6 gram hemoglobin and there is absolutely no patient is not consuming iron in his diet, there are no green vegetables or no fruits like apples, and patient socioeconomic condition is not that much of good, yes, you can provide the physiological doses also. It requires sometimes, it is a supplement. So this is what you have to understand with from patient to patient, from person to person. You should not make any specific thing, every patient you must give this formula, you must give this medicine. It's not specific. For every patient, it varies from person to person. And that's why antenatal care, definitely there is a role of all those things. And if you feel that patient's hemoglobin is quite good, if you do the CBCSR and patient's condition is quite good, don't give iron calcium in the material doses. In fact, they causes a lot of troubles to the patient. So judge that patient. That is most important thing. What should we give to stop the purgatives or stop the antacids from the biochemic system of medicine? That was the question. I think day before yesterday we have discussed that one combination, number 4. Yes, it is for constipation. And you can give that remedy to the patient if you don't know anything specifically related with what is the patient's requirement. But according to the situation, you have to find it out. If patient is coming to you with a typical presentation that he gets accumulated lot of stools in the rectum only, motility is quite good, but at the local level there is a paralytic like feeling and sigmoid colon, it never works, and that's why it is saturated over there, you give the cilicia. So it depends, it varies. Again, same is true for the antacids also. There is no need to give antacid. You have number of remedies in homeopathy as well as in biochemic system. We have told, we discussed the natrum phosphoricum on that day. It's another remedy, natrum sulfuricum on that day, where the pathology is specifically related with the GI tract of the individual. So whenever it is related with the GI tract of the human being, specifically at the level of a stomach, gastritis, acid secretion is more. Think of a natrum phosphoricum first. It has a typical yellowish coating on the tongue. Yellowish vomiting is there. And it immediately solves the problem. Sometimes you might require natrum phosphoricum along with natrum sulfuricum. So in such types of cases, you can think of a number 25, which is indigestion. So you accordingly you have to think and you can use. Yes, we'll going to discuss all those combinations. 25 we'll going to discuss. Today I will going to discuss only from 6 to 10. Already we have discussed about the first 5. We'll going to discuss the 6 to 10 in next few lectures. So that I will going to discuss whenever I will discuss 25 number. There was again one question, congenital hydrocele, which biocombination? Again, my suggestion is that you should not fix your bio combination depending upon pathology. You understand the pathology. What is there in hydrocele? First important thing, if it is congenital, generally congenital things are the products of syphilitic miasm. All congenital disorders are the products of syphilitic miasm. You have to understand this condition first. What is there inside in the hydrocele? Hydrocele, there is an accumulation of a fluid. You have to remove it from that place. So you have to understand the pathophysiology and accordingly select your remedy. Which is the remedy which works for elimination of a water from that area? Intercellular spaces or outside the cells, if water is there accumulated, most important remedy for the eliminative purposes is natrum sulfuricum. Think accordingly so that you can use them. And second important thing, you have to understand the pathophysiology. Don't fix it. Yes, sir has told natrum sulfuricum, give natrum sulf. It is not like that. Sometimes patient might require natrum mur because natrum mur absorbs the water inside the cell. If a patient requires the water contents inside the cell, Natremur absorbs the water because Natremur forms the duplication of a cell, dividation of cells, and it for that purpose it requires water content. It attracts the water because inside the sodium chloride salts are there, and that's why the osmotic pressure is more inside, it absorbs the water. So what purpose it is required, accordingly, according to the situation, you have to select a biochemic or biocombination. Then one more question is there, can we prescribe two biocombinations at a time? First important thing, for what purpose two biocombinations? Because yes, you must watch what are the contents. For example, if you are considering two combinations, for example 5 number and 6 number, because patient is having coryza as well as cup, what is there in the 5 and what is there in the 6, you have to understand. If you find it out exact contents of them, can you understand, can you find it out which are two different, which are the medicines which are present in 5? Day before yesterday we have discussed regarding the 5 number combination. It contains the paramphosphoricum, it contains, logically think about it, logically that which remedies can be there. The paramphosphoricum is there, then kalimuraticum is there, the third remedy kalisulfuricum is there, and if I am not wrong, natremuraticum is there. And now patient is having, if you feel that we have to give for the cough also, and you find it out in the 6 number, you will have again 2 ingredients commonly. The paramphos is also there, the kalimur is also there in 6 also. So 2 ingredients are quite common over there. Only difference is that when you give the 6 number, there is a macphos because it tackles the cough, it tackles the spasm. One more thing is in 6 is natrum sulfuricum, because natrum sulfuricum is a very important remedy in expectoration. It expectorates, it eliminates the thing. It is very important remedy for the asthma. It is very important remedy for the expectoration, which is greenish yellowish. So it tries to throw it away, and that's why natrum sulfuricum is there. And one more remedy which is common in 5 and 6 is natrum muraticum. Now think logically, is it necessary to give 5 and 6 at a time? If a patient is having cough, there is no need to give a 5, just give a 6 and that is sufficient. So you have to understand what biocombination and what its content is there. Always look towards it. You make a habit of watching the contents, read them again and again, and then you will understand whether it is really needed to give it. I will tell you one more example, because this is very important to understand. What happens, generally we think of a rheumatism, and day before yesterday or sometimes it was asked to me that, sir, if a patient is having the rheumatism, rheumatoid arthritis, which remedy, which biocombination shall we use, whether we give the 26. Generally, I suggest that you must have a remedy, a biochemic remedy, which has a capacity to clear that psychotic miasm behind it. Rheumatoid arthritis or rheumatic arthritis is the product of psychotic miasm. Gouty arthritis is the product of psychotic miasm. So if it is so, then you have to understand exactly that you must require a remedy, a combination in which natrum sulf should be there. If you think that if 19 number is there, so open the 19 number. What are the contents of 19 number? If you will find it out, 19 number, there is a paramphosphoricum, there is a kalisulfuricum, there is a macphos, and I think there is a silicea also. These are 4 important ingredients. But natrum sulf is missing. Now, this 19 number is very important for inflammation. It will settle the inflammation, but it will not remove the tendency, and you will require natrum sulfuricum. So what I will do, I will give this combination 19 number along with natrum sulf separately. So I will give Netrumcel along with bicombination number 19 because I want to treat the rheumatoid arthritis. I have to treat that psychotic element. So that will settle the problem. If the patient is having gouty rheumatism, we require two important ingredients in that gouty rheumatism. We'll require the calcarea foss also. We'll require Netrum foss also and Netrum self also. Then think about it, that in which remedy or in which combination there is a calcarea foss also, calcarea foss is present along with calcarea pleura, along with MAC foss. So 26 is there, but 26 is missing Netrum foss and Netrum self. So if you want to give, you want to use them, then along with 26 you give this separately, or you can give 25 plus 26 where you can get all those ingredients immediately. Logic is plays a very vital role in prescribing in such types of cases, and it work, then it works properly, then accordingly, according to the situation, you can get very good results in such types of cases. So when you answer to that, you can prescribe two combinations, but they should not have a same ingredients in them. Don't go on name. Find it out what are their contents, and then you can prescribe accordingly. Then there was one more question, that if a patient comes to me and patient is having some problem, and I think that biocombination 9 is a very good remedy, but out of that one ingredient, ferumphos, I don't want to give. So what should I do, whether to give 9 or whether to give them separately? My suggestion is that better is always that if you don't have a specific combination which you patient desires, give them separately. You should not add which is not required. And that's why if patient requires them in a separate way, you can prescribe them separately. It depends, it varies again from person to person. So you should not make it fixed, and you should, if a patient is, they doesn't require any specific salt, give them separately. That is a good thing. So you have to think whenever you are prescribing. So these are different questions which were asked to me in the last session, last 1.5 hours. So my suggestion is always that you must understand them properly, understand the patient, and accordingly think about the what remedy or what biocombination which you have to use at that time. So this is regarding the question and answer. We'll go ahead with the few more combinations today. Day before yesterday we have learned the first 5 combinations. Anyone who will recollect what are there in first 5 combinations? Have you done the homework? I told you that you do one homework, you make a notebook and write over there the first number combination, the anemia, and what are the contents. The contents are, first is ferrum phosphoricum, second is ferrum phosphoricum, calcarea phosphoricum, natrum muraticum, and caliphosphoricum. These are 4 ingredients which are present in first number. Then that is the anemia. Second we have discussed. Second name is asthma. So if asthma is there, what should be there in our mind? There should be a Natrum sulfuricum, first remedy. Because it is asthma remedy, psychotic miasm predominates over there. To relieve the spasm of asthma, MAC foss should be there. So MAC foss is there. Third important thing, there is a secretions, and you have to tackle with the secretions. The third remedy along with Natrum self, Natrum muraticum plays very vital role. And whenever patient is always in asthma, they become so much of restless. So to tackle that mind, what is important is that you find it out the caliphosphoricum. So you have to understand this, the contents of each and every specific remedy. If you understand them properly, then you can use even for different things those combinations. The third one which we have discussed on that day is the colic. So we know that colic remedy is MAC foss. So MAC foss should be there in the third number. But along with MAC foss, the other entities are also there. And we have discussed that calcarea foss is there. So calcarea fossa, why it is there? Calcarea fossa is there to tackle the abdominal infections. The tuberculous focus over there. Calcarea fossa is also important for the movements of the normal movements of the bowels. So it plays very vital role over there. Then third remedy, which is there in third number, is the natrum sulfuricum, because natrum sulf is very important ingredient of the intestinal tract, and that plays very vital role to tackle. Second important thing, natrum sulf plays very vital role in liver metabolism. So natrum sulfuricum is there in third. And fourth ingredient, I think, if I am not wrong, it is the ferrum phosphoricum, which covers the first stage of inflammation. So any inflammatory focus along with the colic, this third number is useful. Then fourth one, constipation. Just now we have discussed that constipation, one ingredient you know is quite common is the cilicia. But it is, if cilicia is there, it has its own pathophysiology. So along with cilicia, which are the other ingredients which covers over there? So calcarea pleura is there because it has direct action on the muscular wall of the intestine. Calcarea pleura, because when calcarea molecular action motion of the calcarea pleura element is less, generally it gets relaxed, and that's why, because of relaxation, constipation is the result with the calcarea pleura. So it should be there in the fourth. Then one more ingredient, that is the calimuriaticum, which we have discussed that calimur plays very vital role in order to secrete the secretions over there. And an atremur, which is another content of the fourth number. Just now we have finished with the fifth, that's why I will not revise the fifth. We'll go directly with the sixth. And sixth also we have discussed. Page six is cuff combination. Cuff, weight cuff, think of a six. Generally, I used to prescribe for wet cuff biocombination number 6. If it is dry cuff, generally I never prescribe biocombination directly. At that time, I used to consider the justicia mother tincture. Yes, we are going to discuss the mother tinctures, to how to tackle or how to use mother tinctures in day-to-day practice after completing this series. Because patient generally comes in agony, and they require medicine at that time to relieve that spasm. To be patient is coughing again and again in front of you, and he is very much disturbed. In such types of conditions, to palliate, to tackle that immediately, mother tinctures plays very vital role. Mother tinctures are not always homeopathic, but mother tinctures are very good to stop that condition, to tackle that condition at that time. But in wet cup, I used to prescribe this biocombination 6. So first ingredient ferrum fossa, second ingredient calimuriaticum. Both ferrum fossa is 12x potency, calimuriaticum is 3x potency. Ferrum fossa, it is the first stage of inflammation. So inflammatory cough, either because of throat congestion, either because of bronchi, either because of lungs, anywhere it might be the inflammation. Then second important, calimur, if there is exudation, exudation expresses through the cough. If it is croupy at the pharyngeal level, this works a lot. If it is in the lungs, at the level of lungs, the secretions are there, it is also useful. Then there is a spasm like a asthma. So third ingredient should be a macpos, so that spasm of a cough can be tackled very easily with the help of that. So see, these are developed with the help of their proper actions, understanding. The fourth ingredient, which you know with very common, is the natrum muriaticum. Natrum mur is very important remedy in order to absorb the secretions over there. Natrum mur oozes, it oozes the water. If there is molecular action of a natrum mur is missing, yes, there are a lot of secretions, and there are typically fluid accrete which are thrown away. So natrum mur plays very vital role to tackle that, and natrum sulf, eliminative process which can be tackled with the help of natrum sulf. Cuff of any character. So wet cuff, because of any inflammatory pathology. So if there is a pneumonitis, think of six number. Even though there is a tuberculous pneumonitis, think about it in a different manner. You give this, but along with that, you must add the calcarea fossa, which plays very vital role. Because calcarea plus covers the tubercular miasm. You have to understand using those remedies and specifically with such patients according to the diagnosis also. In biochemics, your logic is very important and clinical knowledge is very important to prescribe. So what type of pathology behind the cough is there, accordingly you have to think about it. If it is because of pharyngeal secretions, this biocombination 6 is sufficient. Crow pickup, think about biocombination 6, it will going to give very good results. But if it is of a dry variety, don't think of a 6. Because it is absolutely dry over there. And all those remedies which we have discussed over there, out of which only one remedy which is having very important role in such is to tackle that spasm with a dry cough, give the MacFos. MacFos doesn't produce secretion. MacFos is a remedy which produces, which relieves the spasm. And when patient coughs a lot, continuously coughs, this remedy plays very vital role along with the justicia mother tincture. And that's why we have to understand what may be the cause behind the cough over there. So keep it in your mind that cough combination should not be used just, yes, it is for the cough patient is asking the remedy. You must think whenever you are prescribing. Yes, if patient is asking, doctor, we want the cough remedy, you give the 6 number, that's okay. But if you are treating the case, you must think before prescribing. For what purpose you are prescribing and what it contains. So I think biocombination number 6 is very clear with your mind. We'll go ahead with the biocombination number 7, and everyone knows biocombination number 7 is the diabetes. You will ask me that, sir, is it necessary to give the biocombination number 7 every time? I will say no. It depends. Why a diabetes is there, that is more important. Whether it is type 1, type 2, very important. And understand the disease first. When you are prescribing, understand the disease first. If the patient is with a first variety, that is type 1 diabetes mellitus, you have to understand why type 1 diabetes mellitus is there. If it is there right from the families, type 1 diabetes, sometimes it may reflect as a juvenile diabetes also, and patient becomes insulin dependent since long time. Miasmatic focus is always a syphilitic in such types of cases. It is not psychotic at that time. It is basically a syphilitic. If it is going toward the type 2 variety, type 2 diabetes mellitus, it is psychotubercular miasm which is marked with this type 2. So, with each and every patient, giving a 7 number is not important. You have to understand what are the remedies. Psychotubercular miasm is for type 2 diabetes mellitus, and more psychosyphilitic or syphilitic miasm is more worked with the type 1 diabetes mellitus. So you have to think while prescribing. Now, what are the contents of 7 number? If I am not wrong, the first remedy should be there, the calcarea fos. Why? The calcarea fos is the tubercular remedy. And this miasm in the diabetes mellitus is the psychotubercular miasm. So calcarea fos should be there. Second important remedy generally is psychotic, and that is natrum sulfuricum. We have learned that pathophysiology of natrum sulfuricum, and natrum sulf is definitely mentioned under the general biochemical action or physiological chemical data that this is very important remedy for diabetes mellitus. So these two ingredients should be there. Then what else will be there? If it is because of pancreatitis, so inflammation of pancreatitis is producing transient diabetes, increased levels of sugar. Think of a ferrum phosphoricum. It should be there in the 7 number. Because ferrum phos covers that inflammatory pathology in the pancreas and can remove that. On that day, we have discussed one more remedy. Natrum phosphoricum. because natrium phosphate plays very vital role at pancreatic cells, and that can produce that can affect the secretions of pancreas. So it is directly acting remedy on the pancreas, having very important role in the insulin secretion, and that's why natrium phosphate should be there. And then last one, which is remaining, is nothing but the stress-induced diabetes mellitus, which is quite common. So if stress is there, everyone knows the remedy. If stress is there, cholephosphoricum should be. And this is what the combination of a biocombination, 7 number is there for diabetes mellitus. But you must consider before prescribing for diabetes, why that patient is having diabetes. Generally, type 2 diabetes develops because patient himself is responsible to produce a diabetes mellitus. Type 2 diabetes mellitus should be cured completely with the help of homeopathic remedy. Yes, type 1 may be or may not be, because a miasmatic block or miasmatic problem is always there with type 1, and they are quite or rather difficult to cure. But type 2 diabetes mellitus should be recovered completely. And what else you will going to give? You will not going to prescribe directly a remedy for the patient. Number of practitioners I have seen that they give single dose to the patient and keeps the patient on the placebo. I will suggest that tackle the first sugar levels, control the sugar levels. So very important thing is that you must, depending upon the case, you must select a remedy, either whatever may be the constitutional, but along with that, I generally suggest that give CGGM jam, which plays very vital role to control or to tackle the sugar. Very important remedy. If it never works, one more remedy I will suggest, that Gymnema sylvestri, mother tincture. In fact, it is the Indian drugs. So you must use Gymnema, and it's very good for controlling sugar. Only thing is that CGGM jam works very fast. Gymnema, comparatively, it takes for some time to act. So it never set immediately. If your patient is on CGGM, and if you want to shift him from CGGM to Gymnema, you can let him continue with CGGM for some time. Add Gymnema separately, and later on remove the CGGM from the patient. It varies. It is not always that you do these things, but these are all pros and cons which are useful in your practice to tackle the diabetes mellitus very early. Third, you ultimately, constitutional remedy plays a very vital role. But what I will suggest in this managing the homeopathically diabetes to type 2, you have to add homeopathic management, and you have to tell the patient exactly the diet, what is required. So diet plays a very vital role. I generally suggest that nowadays the very common thought is there, and everyone labels that it is Dixit diet. I will say that this is not Dixit diet. This is a diet which is mentioned since long time. It is called as carbohydrate poisoning, which is responsible to produce the diabetes, type 2 diabetes. And if you go through the internet, search for the things, there are a number of institutes which works for this type 2 diabetes mellitus. You will find the common word carbohydrate poisoning, because our rubric, Indian people's rubric, is imitation mimicry. We imitate the foreigners. And when we used to imitate the foreigners, what do? We follow their habits. The bed tea we require, then afterwards a breakfast we require, again a tea in the office we require, then again some small fruits we require, then a lunch, followed by again a tea, again a coffee, again evening breakfast. So what happens? You go on eating and eating whole day. And if it is so, you are bound to get the type 2 diabetes mellitus. And if you are getting type 2 diabetes mellitus because of your bad food habits, what is important is to remove those bad food habits. It's diabetes going to settle. I generally ask my patient to take food twice a day, in between if he requires the salad, and that's all. Patient can be certain. No tea, no coffee, no milk, nothing in between, no fruits even during in between period. And that's a very good thing that we can settle immediately the type 2 diabetes mellitus. So along with that, I ask one more thing, that regular exercise is needed for a diabetes mellitus. So I suggest, whenever I suggest, first thing I must do it. Then I have a right to say to the patient, yes, you must go for that. This is very important for every practitioner. If you are saying that you should not take tea, you should avoid the tea. If you tell them that you should do the exercises, you must do the exercises. And for that purpose, I am definitely doing regular exercises in order to tell the patient that then I have a right to tell them, yes, exercise is very much necessary. So, diabetes, giving a 7 number is not the treatment. Giving a CGM is jam is not only the treatment. You have to give time to the patient, explain in detail how this type 2 diabetes mellitus develops, then explain them that what is wrong with you, that your food habits are wrong, your daily routine is wrong. Tell them exactly what they require, and then you give whatever your remedy you want, whatever remedy patient wants. So, you ultimately, what patient requires is nothing but the homeopathic management, first the auxiliary measures and then a remedy. Prime importance is the auxiliary measures. Tell them and give guide them for them. Generally what happens, the patient, doctors, they tell them you maintain the diet, you follow the exercise and you will be cured. Patient doesn't understand what to do exactly. What exercise is necessary, and they go for very high fast exercises, again the sugar increases. So which are the exercises which are important? A brisk walk gradually, which should be increased gradually. You told the patient that you go for 45 minutes walk, and patient walks 45 minutes in first day, and next day he stops walking because he starts getting pain in a lower extremity. I generally ask the patient to start it only with 5 minutes, go for 5 minutes, return back 5 minutes, 10 minutes. Next day you go for 6 minutes and return 6 minutes. So every day 2 minutes you go on increasing walking. Speed you maintain first slow, gradually you increase, and when you reach 45 minutes daily, then you start increasing the speed. So there will be no lactic acid formation more and pain will not be there. Because whenever patient do vigorous exercises, whatever glycogen stored in the muscles is there, that immediately gets utilized. Lactic acid is there in the muscles, and that lactic acid starts producing its own effects in the form of a pain. So basically, at that time, if it develops, the patient definitely comes to you with, Dr. Mi chalayla sangitla tumhi, I have started walking and I am getting very severe pain, so I stopped walking and my pain is now better. The pain is because you have started directly on the first day, 45 minutes. So, according to the situation, you must understand this physiology. So if you understand physiology, you can tell them properly and patient can listen them and follow them properly, so that they never get a problem. So any exercise, if patient is starting, they should start it gradually, go on increasing gradually, and they go continue for at least for 45 minutes. Along with one more exercise, which I used to ask my patient to go for Surya Namaskar. Surya Namaskar is the basic good yoga exercise. No other yoga is needed if patient goes for Surya Namaskar at least 12. But what happens, you tell them that to go for Surya Namaskar at least 12, and on first day they do the 12 Surya Namaskar, next day they stop the Surya Namaskar. I used to tell them that you on first day you only do one Surya Namaskar. After 2 days increase to one by one more. So patient will going to get 2, then after 2 days one more. Gradually he starts doing 12 Surya Namaskars, or he can take the rest in between, first 6, rest again 6. Patient never suffers a lot. And if it happens, then patient continues with exercises. And if your patient follows all those things, his diabetes mellitus, his hypertension should be settled with the help of all those things. This is called as homeopathic management. For chronic cases, my suggestion is that you must give the time to the patient, explain to the patient all those possibilities, all those things, whatever needed. Don't just tell them, do a diet. Patient doesn't understand diet. They say that doctor has said me to take a diet. So they goes on eating. That should not. They ask them to how to take a diet, how to do a exercise, what diet is needed. And if you tell them clearly, then patient follows. If you charge them more after giving 1.5 hours, it doesn't matter for them because you have given a special time to them. Handling a chronic cases, give the time, explain each and everything, and then patient can be settled. So this is my aspect of handling the chronic cases. I'm not going to give or just going on prescribing the medicine. Today I have taken two different cases, both cases of a cancer. Early in the morning, 8 o'clock, I got a case of B-cell lymphoma with metastasis. I have given 1.5 hours to that patient. I have detailed, explained everything, why a cancer develops, how this cancer develops, what is needed in order to bring back that harmony. Everything is shared with my patient. He has given me 8,000 without asking me or without putting a question. Because I have given special time, I have discussed each and everything with that patient. Second case was the hepatocellular carcinoma, which I have dealt today. I have given again a time, I have explained all those things. I have explained even prognosis. I have told with the patient's relatives that prognosis is very bad. Already he's tapped number of times. So you have to explain all those details with the patient so that patient can be handled properly. Generally, what happens, we are in hurry. We are impatient and patient is patient. First important thing is that you should have a patience to understand a patient. You should have a patience to explain to the patient what the patient needs. You should have a patient to tell them exactly the exercises, the diet, daily routine, along with all auxiliary measures, along with a homeopathic remedy. I know that I am going away from the biocombinations, but this is very important because the topic of a diabetes came out, and that's why I have given a lot of time to this homeopathic management of a diabetes mellitus, because we have ample cases of a diabetes mellitus. And generally, don't go on prescribing only. Think what may be the wrong in the patient. Why this fellow developed a problem. Today, the first case which we have given, it looked very likely a RM case, but patient has discussed number of things. First important thing, that patient had twice an accident. He had a head injury 8 years back. Then he had a long-standing injury in his lower leg 2 years back, which was not healed very early. It took nearly 1 year. Patient had chronic eczema since childhood. And then there was a grief in that patient regarding his elder daughter, problems with which is son-in-law, and all things I have considered, and we have repertorized, and after repertorization there was a natremur. But along with natremur, at the 4th-5th place there was sulfur also. Aurum was also there nearby natremur. But ultimately, I have selected natrum sulfuricum on the basis of that the history of a head injury, history of a chronic trauma, everything. So ultimately, your prescription depends upon the holistic thing. You have to understand patient very clearly. Same is true when you deal with the diabetes mellitus. So it should not go on prescribing 7 number. Think before that why we are prescribing. First, second important thing, for what you are prescribing. What do you expect when you give the CGM jam? What do you expect from the patient? Why you are giving the CGM jam, and whether your CGM jam is working or not working in that patient. So everything is needed when you prescribe the remedies. So this is what my suggestion is there to about the biochemics and biocombinations whenever you are using. I think it is just 5 to 10 minutes to 4, and patients are waiting there in my OPD. So instead of going towards the next 2 biocombinations, the 8 number or 9 number, 10 number, yes, it will take little bit time. So what we'll do tomorrow, we'll have ample time. Tomorrow I will going to discuss with the mobile only, so that there will be no problem of listening or a sound over there. So we'll discuss regarding all those 3 combinations, Y combinations 8, 9, 10 in tomorrow's session. I think you have understood my aspect of using the biocombination. So I am not prescribing just on the name. I am not prescribing a routine, so as a routine prescriber. You should think, use your logic, and you must understand the disease prior to it, whatever you are prescribing. If you don't know the diagnosis, most important thing, you do it from your physician, ask them to handle the case. If they label with the specific diagnosis, go and read either from the Google, either from the Wikipedia, or either from the medicine book, and then you find it out a remedy for that specific disease. So you should not give directly a remedy to the patient. You think, that is why suggestion is there. And second important suggestion, always give importance to the Davidson book, Hutchinson book, clinical, then surgery, K. Das, clinical surgery. Read the diseases again and again to understand the things clearly. If you are able to understand disease, then you will get confidence to prescribe for them the biochemic remedies, biocombinations, homeopathic remedies, constitutional. But you must know for what purpose you are prescribing. So thank you very much for listening. There were a number of practitioners who were there to, my flow was going on, and that's why I never disturbed that flow. Dr. Rajendra Srimali sir was there. Thank you sir for attending this live session. Number of homeopathic practitioners who are practicing elsewhere, they were there. So thanks a lot to them, and ask all your friends and all the homeopathic practitioners, students, to go live with this session daily at 2:30, so that we can have a lot of clinical conditions. Biocombination, some 7 number you can give for few months till the patient settles. When patient settles, remove that 7 number. My suggestion is to all of you, we can learn in this way different conditions in future also. So today I got the chance to discuss a little bit regarding diabetes mellitus, that I have shared with you. And ask all your friends to subscribe our channel, that is the Divine School of Homeopathy from YouTube, and learn homeopathy over there. And I will ask that all the students that first go through them, first understand the potency problem or all those queries. If you don't get anything, put me a question. I'm there with you definitely. So thanks a lot for attending session, and we'll conclude the session immediately. We'll meet tomorrow at 2:30. Thanks a lot.